right, good evening. I'm Yolanda Kearney. I am the diplomat in residence for the DC Metro region. This evening, I am joined by my colleague, diplomat in residence, Alan DeBose, hosted warmly as ever by Ambassador Ronald Newman of the American Academy of Diplomacy, and joined by Ambassador Pete Bodhi. With that, please, Ambassador Newman, give us a little overview of the Academy, and let's jump right into it. There's a lot to cover with management this evening.
Okay, thank you, Yolanda. It's a real pleasure to be back with you and to be doing this with the diplomats in residence. The American Academy of Diplomacy is a small but high-profile organization. It was originally begun in 1983 by people like Henry Kissinger. George Kennan, of great renown, was one of our founding members. And its purpose has evolved over time a bit. It has now really two major purposes. It is quite small. After the last election, we have 380 members, although I think 16 of them are in sort of frozen status now because they're in the current administration, including Secretaries of State, Defense, and the National Security Advisor, which is a good thing for the Academy, but it's a problem for me because I can't get their dues while they're back in government. But it is an organization of former senior diplomats, mostly career, that means foreign service officers, but not entirely. We have some who were non-career appointees, some who came from intelligence. We have several former directors, administrators of AID, and senior people there. And we have really two major lines of effort, approaches. One is talking to Americans about why diplomacy is important, what diplomacy is. And as part of that program, I'll come back to this show in a minute, but that's why we're doing this. Another part of that program is a couple of podcasts we have. And if you want more kind of feel for the diplomatic life, I refer you to those two podcasts that you can find on the American Academy of Diplomacy website. One is called American Diplomat, and there's a lot of those programs up now. They're little half-hour chats, all kinds of different vignettes out of diplomatic life. The other's called The General and the Ambassador, and we began that because we thought a lot more Americans think they understand the military than understand diplomacy. And so those are a series of conversations with former four-star generals, admirals, and the diplomat they worked closely with, like General Petraeus with Ambassador Crocker, or General Breedlove when he was commander of NATO with Tori Newland, who was then Assistant Secretary for European Affairs and is now back out of retirement as Undersecretary for Political Affairs. And so we have these podcasts, lecture programs, various things. And the other line of effort, that we're engaged in is talking to the department, talking to Congress about things we could think could be done better in diplomacy, including things like professional education, how we get diplomats out of fortress embassies a little more frequently so they can do their job on the street, and a whole variety of those issues. As part of this business of being interested in the foreign service and in diplomacy, we joined with diplomats in residence in this idea, which I have to say, full credit, was originally an idea of Yolanda's. And the idea was that we would pair in five programs a serving foreign service officer in a particular cone, tonight management, with a senior foreign service officer, one of our members, who has had a distinguished career and came out of that cone, and to talk back and forth about what the reality of that profession is. And this is particularly important because, as I'm sure many of you know or have learned, if you take the Foreign Service exam, you have to sign up for one of the five specializations or cones. I don't know why they're called cones. They just are. You have to live with it. And they are political, economic, public affairs, management, and consular. If you are good enough to pass the Foreign Service exam, you will come in the cone you selected, and you will stay there. because changing cones is very, very difficult. Used to be a little bit easier. People would game the system. They'd think, oh, I can get in easier in one cone and I'll switch to another. Don't do it. It's a bad idea. So pick one that you really genuinely like. And that's why we wanted to do these programs, so we could bring people a little higher, more textured sense of what these cones are. And I hope that's what we'll achieve. The sessions are being recorded. We have to wait until the State Department finishes processing them. This is another early lesson in the State Department. It doesn't always happen quickly. But they will be posted when we have them on the website of the American Academy of Diplomacy. I think they'll be somewhere else as well. And so with that introductory note, Yolanda, I'll pass it back to you.
Thank you, sir. So there is a lot to cover when it comes to management. I think that all of the diplomats and residents, when we talk about management officers, particularly at post, we refer to them as our chief operating officers. So just to start, we've shared your bios already of Astor Bodia and Alan, but I'll ask that Foreign Service question. Tell us a little bit about yourself and your journey to management, if you would start for us, Ambassador Bodia.
Sure. Well, thank you, Lana, and thank you for letting me join you tonight. I'm happy to do this because I'm a proud management officer, and I had worked out very well for me. And I spent a long career in management and then sort of jumped into senior leadership and became a DCM and ambassador 3 times. But I always felt that I had a tremendous advantage because of the management experience I gained as a management officer in my younger years, the different things I got to do as a management officer. I'm what they call an FSBR, Foreign Service Brat Retired. I grew up in the Foreign Service. And so I knew a little bit more about it than most people do when they came in. But I was working in the civil service at the International Trade Commission, where I'd done a lot of general services type work and management type work. So when I came in, there was a paucity of management officers in the Foreign Service at that time. So I thought this would be a good thing to apply as, and I could get in that way. Interestingly, I came in a surge. This was in 1981, right after we had the problems in Iran. We still had the hostage situation just ended, and we were bringing in more Foreign Service political officers because Congress felt there was a deficit of political officers in the Foreign Service. So my entry class, despite my best laid plans, I was one of 3 management officers out of 45 people brought in. I went out as a consular officer and then broke my leg playing softball, and it changed the course of my entire career because I was medevaced and not allowed to go back to post. And my wife Tanya and I suddenly found ourselves in Kathmandu, where I was the budget officer, the budget and fiscal officer, the only what they call junior officer at post. So I sort of backstopped everybody. From there, I went to Hamburg as management officer. I came back, I was the special assistant to the assistant secretary and diplomatic security as the Bureau of Diplomatic Security was being set up. I went off to Bulgaria as management officer in Sofia. This watched communism fall in 1989. Then went out to Copenhagen as management officer there for 4 years. And then became a DCM, went back to Kathmandu as DCM. And after that, then went back into the management cone again and was management counselor in New Delhi, which was an enormous job. I had a section of about 1,200 people working for me. I was brought back to Washington to take on the job of the head of the Office of Management Policy. And then I went on and switched gears again and went on to Frankfurt, where I was consul general, then DCM in Pakistan. After being DCM in Pakistan, ambassador in Malawi, was there for a year, curtailed, went out as the second ambassador to Iraq, and then was made ambassador in Nepal. And then when I thought I was retiring, was asked to go out and be ambassador to Libya. So it's been a long, varied journey. But I have to say, in all of those different things, my management skills were called upon. And even though I was ambassador, even though I was the second ambassador in Iraq, I was very, very engaged in the process of the transition from the military providing the support platform to the State Department doing it. In Frankfurt, when I was consul general, one of the reasons I was selected to go out at that time is we were building a new facility there. So I was able to take that on, get that done during my tenure there. So a lot of different things like that.
You know, when I hear those numbers, a staff of 1,200 as a public affairs officer, we used to have relatively large, members of staff, but I'm always amazed because management, as the name of the career track might imply, you guys have huge numbers of folks who work for you. I want to get into that a little more as we talk. And for the record, we have both ambassadors this evening are Foreign Service, can I use the word brats? They are both children of Foreign Service officers, which is really interesting. So Alan, tell us a little bit about yourself, your background, and your journey to management.
Thank you, Yolanda. So my background is completely different. The conversation tonight, I think one thing I'll be able to address is transition from the private sector into working for the U.S. Foreign Service. I had over 17 years of experience working in the private sector before I ended up joining U.S. Foreign Service. So I had a family in place, and that may be an issue that people want to discuss as well. My background in the private sector was in finance and also business operations. And I had what someone calls career ADD. And whatever I was doing, I get bored with it after a year or two. And then when I saw an ad from Colin Powell saying, we're looking for management types, I thought, this is perfect. Every 2 to 3 years, I'm moving on to something else. And my portfolio was wide. It's not very narrow, which was one of the issues I had in the private sector. Well, be careful what you ask for, because I joined U.S. Foreign Service as a management officer. And I'm going to try, if I can remember, to use the term generalist. And you'll understand why you start to learn about us, that we have in the U.S. Foreign Service specialists and also generalists. The generalists are referred to as Foreign Service officers, and there are only 5 career tracks that Ambassador Newman mentioned, but IT, facility management, general services, finance, those are specialist positions. So sometimes the terminology can get confusing. So if I'm gonna try my best to use generalist for one of the 5 positions and specialist for all the others. And back to my background. So basically when I joined, I did tours in Mexico, Ecuador, and the United Arab Emirates. And one of the other things I had the opportunity to do is work in some human resources positions back in Washington, as well as with overseas buildings operations, which is a bit unique for a lot of the management officers, because these are the people who our facility managers report to, and they're responsible for all the real property abroad. And when our management staff develops into management officers, you don't go straight to a management job. You normally take one of the subset roles as you're working your way up. And so by working in facility management, most management officers just don't have an opportunity to do that. They tend to do some of the other positions frequently because they're trying to get overseas. That's the reality. But with that said, I'll be able to talk about some of that unique experience as well tonight. So Yolanda, I'm going to hand it back to you.
Well, you've offered me a beautiful segue into the structure of this work. So let's talk a little bit about some of these subspecialties that the Foreign Service specialists cover at post, which are managed by our management generalist. So first, let's first of all talk about the things, if we can sort of split them into two sides. Those things that take care of our staff, like MED, and those things that take care of the running of the embassy. So Ambassador Bodie, why don't you tell us a little bit about, you know, as you go to post, for folks who don't understand how we're structured, how do we take care of our folks at post, and where does management fit into that broader portfolio?
Thank you, Linda. Well, management is key to that, because the whole reason we exist as a management section and management officers, their whole wherewithal, is that we provide the infrastructure, the platform for everybody else to do all of their jobs, everything, whatever that might mean. And there's different ways you do it. We've talked about the subspecialties. Obviously, we have a budget section that handles the budget, personnel, HR, that's self-evident. We have a general services section. Well, in the Foreign Service, that's a very important section because that manages not just space in the office building and supplies and procurement, but it also takes care of the leasing, the housing, the shipping, all of the travel, motor pools, all the different things in that type of physical aspects of support of an embassy. I would not make the distinction that, from my perspective, that's always also been part of taking care of people, very critical part. We also have our other specialties like Med, which is a very unique, our medical bureau. And depending on the size of the embassy and where you are, it determines the level of staff you would have there. You know, the world certainly has changed a lot medically since I joined in 1981. And places where we used to have doctors, we don't have them anymore because we don't need them anymore. Med has expanded greatly on their nurse practitioner and physician's assistance program. I found my experience as a management officer that works very, very well. We get incredible medical support from all of them. And all of those people are supported by a regional doctor, the RMO, regional medical officer, who usually covers four or five posts. In addition to the normal, general practitioner type doctor, we have regional psychiatrists, which have a much wider area. They usually have to cover, I think they often cover up to 12, 15 posts, but they provide regional support in the providing psychiatric support for people who, and community health support and mental health. So they do a lot of work like that. And it's a very critical part of our operation. And it's one that I've seen during my tenure in the Foreign Service expand greatly. And quite frankly, they do a number of things that people don't think about. Regional psychiatrists coming in as an ambassador, as a DCM, I always look forward to their outbrief because they were able to tell you things about morale at your post, about yourself and your management style that people at post might not like so to hear so much or might be able to hear so much. So they play a very useful role. But the part of all of this is that the management counselor at a post, the management officer at a post, all of these support functions work for them. And they provide this for the rest of the mission there. And it's a very critical role in how it's done.
Thank you.
You know, Yolanda, if I could just note that you do have, you have a lot of individual specialists, but you have a lot of small posts where you are multi-hatted. And I'm sure Alan could talk about that as well as Ambassador Bodie. I think I had the ultimate management experience in that respect. My first tour in the Foreign Service was in Senegal. We had a one-person post in the Gambia. Ambassador was accredited in both. The one person died. I ended up driving a coffin down, helping seal up the one person, and I became the chargé, the one person in the Gambia for 3 months. And I did everything from lobbying the president of the Gambia UN vote on which China got the seat to being the Class B cashier, making out pouch invoices, meeting the airplane courier when they didn't overfly Bathurst, and passing on pouches. So you could, whether you're a management officer or not, you can find yourself doing management, and you certainly need to know it. I mean, it was a great experience for me because a lot of Foreign Service officers really don't get a lot of supervisory experience until quite far along in their career. And you get this much, much earlier as a management officer. So I'll button up now.
Yeah, don't button up too much. So Alan, you mentioned earlier domestically working as a facility management, but can you tell us a little bit more about the keeping up of the facilities and the things that support the people who do the work? So we've talked about Med and all of those things, but what about the actual, you know, the meat of it, IT and facility management, et cetera?
Sure. So let me kind of set some context. Everything that we're talking about, most of what we're talking about, you can find at careers.state.gov. And in all honesty, it is kind of hard to understand unless you get in an overview, because it's like learning an entirely different language and an organizational structure and all that. There's actually a site. When you go to careers.state.gov, there's an assessment you can take where you put in your interests and it will tell you we think you match to the different career tracks. And when I did that assessment, and it was a similar assessment back in 2005 as it is today, Mine was like an 80% match for management, and the next closest one was about 20%. So I'm a management personality, good, bad, whatever it is, it's reality. And actually, I think it's pretty accurate. So with that said, think of management as maybe an executive at a small business. So I'm gonna use maybe a restaurant analogy. If you have someone who's in charge of a decent sized restaurant, they're supposed to be managing the restaurant, but you know, stuff happens. They may end up having to bus tables. They may have to wash the dishes. They may be at home on a day they're supposed to be off and they get called in because nobody showed up. The cook didn't show up that day. And so I was listening to Ambassador Newman talk about some of the responsibilities of the IT personnel. And I was, oh, yep, I did that too. Yep, I did that as well. So essentially, that's one of the reasons I try to use the word generalist is think of our specialists as subject matter experts. Their role is, if it's finance, they are the go-to person for finance if they're a post. They're not always a post. If they're IT, we have different requirements for IT, but they are the go-to person. But if you're a management generalist, we want you to be plug and play as much as we can. I mean, there are limitations, common sense, but we want you to be able to be put in position where you can hold the fort down until you can get some help from DC. And usually that means it'll get there when it gets there. So it's not necessarily going to be overnight. It might be 90 days before DC gets that help you really need. So you have to be able to manage. They're not going to leave you literally by yourself, but it might be a phone call away instead of someone coming in to do the work. And I've literally been on the phone saying, what do I do? Okay, I do. All right, I put that switch. Now what do I do next? I have literally been there. And that's what they expect from management personnel is to be able to roll their sleeves up and do the dirty work. Now, when you get to one of these posts, and we have what's called locally employed staff, and our locally employed staff are crucial to management. They're, to all the different careers, they're important, but to management, they are crucial because they literally do the day to day. And many times they have a level of expertise in some of the processes that we have no clue, but we have to get up to speed because we have to know what they're doing. So whenever we have that LE staff, if you're at a well-functioning post, they're going to be doing a lot of things and you're just reviewing and making sure everything's in line, communicating back to DC, working on the policy, reporting to the front office. But it's hard to stay in that position. Even at a well-functioning post, it's hard to stay in that state indefinitely. And again, for those in the private sector, think about it. How many of you work for businesses where everything is going great for 5-10 years in a row? I work for several big name companies in the private sector that don't even exist today because they went bankrupt or they were merged into some other organization. So even though they were doing well, they evolved. So here we are as management types, and we have to be able to be as much as possible, have a general understanding of all the management roles. What do they say? A mile wide and an inch deep. You have to have enough knowledge to be able to kind of step in or at least know when to call for help, but you're not necessarily going to be the finance person who really knows all the details. Now, I will say one last thing before I hand the floor back. We have our own school, it's called Foreign Service Institute. So really, when you go through the process of being selected to become a US Foreign Service officer, one of the criteria we're looking at is to see if you have the ability to learn. So if you are a widget maker, it really doesn't matter if you can demonstrate that you have the ability to learn, because we will send you to our school, Foreign Service Institute, and teach you everything you need to know to be a successful management officer. So that's why we have this odd position of like a finance manager, human resource manager. There's something you never find in the private sector. Well, you see this at small posts a lot overseas. So these people will go to Foreign Service Institute and spend a couple of months studying finance, and then a couple months studying human resources, and then get out to post, and they're supposed to be the subject matter expert in both those things. Well, of course, they're going to depend on some help from DC. But the bottom line is, that's our attitude, is you have to have the flexibility to be able to cover a lot of different areas as a generalist. Specialists, again, subject matter experts, they come in with that expertise, whereas the management officer, normally when they come in, they're more potential than actual experience.
Both, and there, you've both said some really interesting things, and I want to dig into a little bit of this. First, I would like for everyone here, we have better than 200 people, to answer, you know, a two-question poll, two little questions. First, we want to know where you're joining us from, where are you, and then how'd you hear about us today? How'd you hear about this session today? And then I'd like Alan and Ambassador Bodie, and actually you too, Ambassador Newman, given your experience as chief of mission, I would very much like to hear your views on the interagency. So we've talked in the other career tracks about how it works with the other agencies at POST. For those who don't know what an ICAS is, I would very much for you like to talk, I'd like for you to tell us a little bit more about how it is as a management officer, you work with our colleagues from other agencies at POST. Ambassador Bodie, why don't you start us off?
Sure, thank you. Well, one of the things that people don't realize is that when we talk about embassies overseas, since the end of World War II, I think is when the trend really started, virtually over most embassies, virtually over half the people resident there are not State Department people. They're people from other agencies that have business there, Department of Commerce. We have lots of law enforcement overseas. We have the FBI, we have the Secret Service. In some posts, we have actually Treasury attachés. Most posts, we have defense representatives, either people in the Office of Defense Cooperation or the attaché corps. But what this means is that we're really hosting the federal government overseas. And what the State Department is the platform from which the federal government works overseas at our various embassies. And as the management officer, you're sort of the key support officer for all these other agencies. Now, used to be, and this has been something that's evolved, God, over the last six, seven decades of how the funding for this was handled. And we at State always felt that we bore too much of the burden of the cost of other agencies being overseas. And I think this was generally true. It was the subject of many GAO studies, and we're still working the formula out. But the latest version to address that problem or that issue was ICAS, where people sign up for services and get agencies sign up and get billed. ICAS has been in place, God, 10, 15 years, but it's worked very well in that it provides much better accounting. It lets people sign up for the services they need. It's held State to probably a higher standard because there's been a much greater focus on what the actual costs are. But it also has led to some lively management issues. Is this management by consensus? No, it's not. It's an accounting system. But what's the role of the management officer in administering this? I'll just tell a quick vignette about when I was the management counselor in Delhi. Here we are, this enormous post. I think at that time, the entire size of the mission was well over 2,000 people. And with our Indian staff, probably closer to 3,000. We had probably, I think, 25 federal agencies there. Everything from the Library of Congress, you name it, they were there. And when I arrived at POST, I went to my first ICAS meeting, and I discovered that the ICAS Council had put a process in place that as the management counselor responsible for a budget in those days of about $50 million, I wasn't allowed to spend more than $1,500 or something without going to them and getting permission. And I said, guys, this isn't going to work, and we're not going to do this. And well, we've decided, so it doesn't matter. We're not going to do this. And we came up with a process where I would have to go to them only if, in fact, I raised their bill by more than 1% a year or something like that. But what we found is many agencies are not well funded overseas. So they look for ways to save money. And this has been a way that they've done it. So it's a very, very healthy dialogue. But what we were able to do in New Delhi is it very, very much became a cooperative effort. we were, was able to convince some of the agencies that certain smaller agencies weren't getting their fair share, and that meant state and those agencies then had to pick it up. And the quality of our services weren't what they were supposed to be. And by having them help set the standards for the service, we're able to raise everybody's standard of living. So it's just the type of thing, but it's a fascinating type of work you get involved in. And when you talk about support work overseas, I don't think people have the understanding that this is the level of detail you can get into. There's one key thing I want to raise here, and I appreciate Ron's views on this too, is I was very successful at doing this because I always had my ambassador support. I worked for a political ambassador who had been the head of the Peace Corps, Dick Celeste. And the first thing Dick did on his second day at post was ask me to go over the entire budget with him. And he understood the budgeting as well as I did. Having that support is critical to any successful management officer and having access to an ambassador and a DCM. But that's one of the things you have to do.
Well, I totally agree with you, Peter. But it works in reverse too. Too few ambassadors in my experience are managerially literate.
Exactly.
And bother to learn how a budget works. And occasionally I've seen management officers who were able to utilize that, you know, to give very simplistic answers that, well, you know, that's not in the budget, Mr. Ambassador, when, you know, there's all kinds of room for maneuver. You must have been absolutely a terror of your management subordinates when you were ambassador because they knew you knew this stuff. But it, you know, ultimately efficiency works with loyalty up and down.
Exactly. And
if you got the expertise and the person respects it, that's really critical. But it's equally critical because a lot of ambassadors and DCMs, frankly, don't have the experience they ought to have on the management side, that management officers really, really understand their portfolios. And they really understand how they can maneuver within the law, you know, within the law. You don't want anybody going to jail. But you need to figure out, a lot of times, you know, your mission is we're trying to accomplish something. How can we do that? How can we find the resources and make them available to accomplish a mission?
So Ron, I couldn't agree more. One of the key points I wanted to make tonight was a successful manager is not learning how to say, it's learning how to say no, but not saying no. It's learning, it's basically saying how to get to yes. And what I was lucky on is I had bosses that beat it into me saying, your job is when somebody asks you to do something, you think it's crazy, say, what are you trying to do? And let me figure out how we're going to be able to get you to do that. And if you have that approach, it works better. But the simple no is not a recipe for much. Yolanda, there's one other point I don't want to lose before we move on is we mentioned that our locally engaged staff and the critical relationship between not just the management officer, but the Americans, the entire American staff and them. And I think that's something to remember is they provide a great deal of support. They provide continuity. But one of the things we have to do throughout this as a management officer is you're responsible for internal controls. There's a whole series of checks and balances that the department provides. It's all there. It's a very simple process, but you have to make it a priority to do this. And what we found around the world is sadly, human nature being what it is, this is around the world, domestically too, malfeasance happens. But when we look into why it ever gets to be a bad case or why it went on so long, it's because people didn't take the time to do the management controls that they're supposed to do on a regular basis. And the department trains you in this, they provide the system in this. It's no fun, but it's something you have to do. And I want to stress that because it's part of good leadership and it's part of successful being a successful management officer. It also protects your locally engaged staff when you do this because they know you're doing it. And the fact that people know they're being checked is generally a recipe for honesty across all cultures.
Very, very much so. So I want to share the results of our polls. We can let you know where the 215 of you this evening are coming from. And then I'd like to talk a little bit about what the career looks like early, middle, and late. So first of all, here we are. Thank you, folks who are overseas, whatever wee hour of the morning it might be. Thank you for joining us, our West Coast folks as well. And then for those of you who heard about this from DIR, Diplomat in Residence, or a Career Center, thanks again for joining us. So Alan, please, why don't you start? Tell us a little bit about what the career looks like early on. You've talked a little bit about this, but early and mid-career, and then Ambassador Bodie, what does it look like at the senior ranks?
So I'll start with this is what I always tell people when I'm recruiting them. I say, after you've completed the entire process, once your fanny hits the seat in our A100 orientation class, you are a Foreign Service officer. Doesn't matter if you're 24 or 44, if you have 4 years of experience or 24 years of experience, our attitude is we're going to teach you what we need you to know to have a successful career, but you have to be able to learn it. We also have our requirements, and some of those requirements, the very first requirement tour is a consular officer. There's several reasons they do this, but it's actually a good way to kind of learn a lot about how the embassy or the consulate works, even though it may not be a management responsibility. And with that said, consul is probably the most similar to management compared to the other career tracks. So someone who works in consular can actually learn a lot about management operations. So for example, the first two tours of when a generalist comes in, they are going to normally do two-year tours. I'm speaking generally, they normally do two-year tours, and one of those is going to have to be doing consular work. Sometimes they do two-year tours of consular work. That's not that unusual because ultimately Uncle Sam's needs take priority over everything else. So regardless, once someone has checked off that box, then the general thinking is, as a management officer, you want to start getting into some of the subset management positions as quickly as possible, so you start learning the work. You don't want to go straight to management. And this is the thing that we always preach in management, and it's really hard to get when you're entry level, but it's a reality. If you rush to a management role as opposed to maybe doing a finance job or an HR job or a general services job first, you're setting yourself up for problems because you won't have enough of an understanding of the foundation work. So in my case, I did my consular tour in Mexico, and then I did what's called general services officer in Ecuador. And in Ecuador, we normally would have a facility manager. We didn't have a facility manager. So what we had was a local facility supervisor who really didn't have the same skill set, which meant as the US General Services Officer, I also had to supervise the facility staff, which is normally supervised by a separate American. So this was giving me a broad experience in operations of the consulate general in Guayaquil, Ecuador. This can be the most painful of all the experiences because it's like mid-level management in the private world. You're getting all the work and you're expected to know everything and you're on the learning curve. Plus you have to supervise people, a lot of people. Many times, as Yolanda mentioned, we are the largest group at an embassy or a consulate just because of the nature of the work. And general services tends to be the largest of the groups within management. So most management officers are going to try to get that GSO tour as quickly as possible. And then after that, they start feeling out what they want to do next. Some will say, I want another GSO tour. Some will say, I'm going to try to do some HR work or some finance work. Some will say, I think I want to go for management. And there are two ways they can do it. Sometimes they will go where they will be a deputy management officer and they have a management counselor over them. Or another way is they go to one of these teeny tiny posts where there are only five people there, five Americans there. So they're management, but they're supporting a very small organization. So the bottom line is, after that, it's kind of up to you which direction you want to take and how aggressively you want to pursue it. But the one caveat I would say to anybody, and especially management, is you need to be checking all the time in your career to see what makes sense for you at that point in your career. Because sometimes people do bite off more than they can chew. And if you want to continue to have a good reputation for knowing what you're doing and being able to manage operations, then you have to know what you're doing and be able to manage operations. So you can't just have the title of management officer, but everybody's talking behind your back about he doesn't know what he's doing. We can't manage operations. It will end up hurting you. So that's the one thing I always say is get into management as quickly as you possible. And that's normally what happens. But then make sure you have a decent foundation before you start trying to bite off on the big positions.
Ambassador Bode, clearly the senior levels of this career track are, as your title says, ambassadorships and senior leadership. But what does it look like after mid-level as you go into the senior level? What types of jobs might one expect to have?
Well, I think it's been described well what to do up to there, but I think the key is in the managing tone. So you want to go on to progressively larger posts as a management officer or management counselor. I think it's really important, as my colleague just said, to get the experience, become well-rounded. But I think there's a few things that I just want to add that in addition to the specific position you should be looking for, there's things you should be doing along the way. One, and this applies to all cones, but one, you should be very quickly making yourself the person, that the go-to person. That if your boss comes in and says, we have a problem, or we have a visit coming in this weekend and we need somebody to go to the airport at 4 a.m. and we need this or need that, be the one to raise your hand. Become the person that people can rely on. And when you're known as somebody that's reliable, it's like the same in most organizations, good things happen. You have to establish a reputation for yourself in that regard. Two, as you go in, and it doesn't matter what position you're in, at an entry-level management position or a mid-level or a senior one, don't accept things as they are. You know, we one of the things we don't talk about in recruiting, but the State Department's generally in my 41-year career always experienced a paucity of funding. So we're constantly trying to do things and not have enough, quite enough money to do it. And that's particularly hard when you're the person, the man or woman, responsible for the housing and the welfare of a large community overseas, and you know what has to be done, you just don't have the money to do it. So you have to figure out ways to do it, you have to figure out ways to prioritize. But my point is, don't accept things as they are. And the fact that this has been a terrible situation for many.
You're muted, you got muted, Alan. Peter, you got muted.
Oh, sorry. Don't accept things as they are, be the person who can move this stuff along. Now, how do you do that? That's a much harder process. One of the things I learned early on in my career is, even though I might be the junior budget officer in Kathmandu, I had to have a network back in the department of people who could help me do my job. We had regional people, we had other people. I had to, in my executive, the EX office of the Bureau. So there had to be a whole thing. And I always would make a point of always going back. And usually because I served most of my career in hardship posts, I was back in the department once a year in R&R and whatever, but I established this network that served me throughout my whole career to get things done. We talked, all of these things basically come down to resilience and adaptability, but those are the skills you have to have before you really think or put yourself forward for the senior management positions. When I was in Delhi, I arrived in Delhi, and quite frankly, I was a FS1, be the equivalent of a colonel in the army. And the job was a 2-star general job. I was very junior for the job, but I got it, lucked into it. And I think I sort of arrived there and said, okay, now what am I gonna do? But I saw challenges there that had to be done. We had a very large staff, and it always had tremendous issues, labor issues there. But one of the things we took on was that despite the fact the embassy had been there for 55 years at that point, our staff didn't have adequate health insurance. This was a 3-year process of working with the staff, the employee association, the Office of Overseas Employment, Indian insurance companies. it was one of the toughest things I've done in my entire career. But we, at the end of the day, this group of people who didn't want to take this problem on, the local staff who thought they had a better system, ended up being well insured and ended up getting health insurance that was better than the health insurance I carry today as a retired federal employee. Those are the types of issues where you have to take on the big issues too. Again, I couldn't have done that without the support of my DCM and the ambassador. But because I developed this network, because I developed credibility along the way back in Washington, we were able to get these things done. And I think that's very, very important. Take on the tough stuff. Too many people in our business don't do that. And if you're willing to take on the tough stuff, then as you morph out of being a management officer and something else, that's when you get to be a DCM. And when you're particularly lucky, that's when you get chosen to be an ambassador one day, because you're known as somebody who's willing to go and do the tough things and get things done and go places where other people don't go.
Sir, you have raised a really interesting point, and that's back in Washington. So a quick view of the Undersecretary for Management's page shows that there are quite a lot of things that are under management that I would not, before I started in the Foreign Service, I would not have assumed would be there. So some of them you've already talked about. Alan talked about the Foreign Service Institute where we train. That's in Northern Virginia. There's the Office of Management Strategy, of course, the Bureau of the Comptroller, Overseas Bureau Operations, Medical Services, Global Talent Management, that's recruitment. All of that makes perfect sense to me, budget and planning. But then there are things like diplomatic security and the Bureau of Consular Affairs. Can you talk to us a little bit about the structure of management in Washington?
I'll try. Consular Affairs is something that has been there for many, many years. And I don't know how it got there initially. I think it probably goes back to the early Foreign Service Acts. But it's something that, because of the level of resources that the consular function takes overseas, it's also in recent years, the level of resources it generates pre-COVID because of the fees it creates, that its management is the logical place for it to be. And I think that in it there it will remain. Diplomatic security, you have to realize something, that until the mid-1980s, 1985, there wasn't a Bureau of Diplomatic Security. It was an Office of Security, which was part of the old Bureau of Administration. When I was a special assistant in DS at that time, it was when the legislation was passed that created the Bureau of Diplomatic Security, because it was a very important function. We'd had some of the terrorist attacks in Lebanon and other things where people felt this needed more attention, deserved its own bureau. And also was a tremendous, the resources that go to it, understandably, are very, very large and have to be. And it was felt that it has to be under the Undersecretary of Management. There have been attempts over the years to move it. It's never been successful. Everyone feels, at least I feel very strongly, certainly as a management officer, it belongs under the Secretary of Management because that's where it gets the proper attention. There was some talk at one point of putting it under the one of the deputy secretary positions, but it stayed with management. But I think those are things, what's important is it doesn't matter whether it's with the undersecretary for management or with the deputy secretary. They are critical functions that have gotten more and more important, certainly during the course of my career, because the safety of all, keeping all of our people and their families safe overseas is so critical to our success. And it's so critical to our policy implementation because, as we've seen, certainly in one of my previous posts, when people are killed and hurt, our policy gets sidetracked as well.
Absolutely. I'd like to talk a little bit about what you wish you'd known about management before you started. Alan and Ambassador Bodie, now that you've been in, you've both had fantastic careers so far. What do you wish you'd known before you started? Alan.
All right, I'll go first. It was actually not a surprise, in all honesty, because probably I had been working in private industry. Had I come right out of school or not had more experience, I probably would have had a shock to my system about how much responsibility there is. But because I had kind of been around and see how things work in the private industry, it would, the thing I saw was essentially that in the private industry, you tend to have narrower responsibility, whereas in as a management officer in the U.S. Foreign Service, you get it all. So for example, I have some colleagues, I started with IBM. And so I have some colleagues who work with me at IBM, and they would call me and ask me questions about how are you guys doing this at your post? And they were earning more than I was, and they had higher titles than I did, but they had fewer people reporting to them overall and narrower responsibility. So that's what I mean, that the one thing I didn't really expect, but it wasn't a shock still, was that there's really so much a wide responsibility when you are a host. It costs Uncle Sam a lot of money to send us overseas. So we're not just sending bodies over there. We're sending people over there who supervise, who have to be leaders, who have to manage processes, who have to manage people. And that's something that where I think I knew before, until you actually start doing it, you don't feel it. But once you have to start doing it, it's kind of like I always use analogies. And imagine if anybody who've been silly enough to have children, and you have one, and you're trying to help them with their homework, and the other one walks in and says, I just have one question, just a minute. You say, I'll be with you in 10 minutes. Okay, just let me get my one question. All right, just 10 minutes, I'll be with you. All right, it's just one question, that's all I need. That's the life of a management officer right there. And that's what you kind of have to adapt to, is you have your customer needs and you have to make sure they're taken care of because they have to do their jobs post. And so you have to triage that one person who's kind of getting on your nerves might actually need to be moved up to the front of the line because there's a valid reason they need your attention right now. So what I did pick up is you have to be able to truly figure out the lay of the land, how to manage up and down and sideways. You have to really understand the entire process more so than I would say in the private world where it tends to be a little more segmented and easier to understand.
So Ambassador Bodhi, I have the same question for you. What do you wish you'd known before you started? And then I'd like to hear from the three of you, put your future vision goggles on, and let's talk about what we think the future of management work will look like. For these candidates who are seeking out these positions, what might they expect their work to be like 15, 20, 25 years from now?
Okay, well, I guess the one thing I sort of knew, but you'd never really understand till you get in the job, is this is a 24/7 job. And one of the things you learn in the management cone is you can have a great day, but your work is never done. There's always another problem. There's always something that still needs doing. So learning how to deal with that and making sure you get it done. One of some tricks I've done along the way is I always said, every week there had to be something better at any embassy I was. Something had to look physically better, work better, do something. And it sounded silly, but it meant at the end of the year, there were 52 things that were going better than at the beginning of the year. And people, my customers, noticed. And that was very, very important. I think if I had to think of things I wish I'd known more about, is the importance for equity. And that when you're a management officer, or even as one of the more the subsets, you really had to look at who's getting what at post. Is it fair? Is it equitably done? Things, it seems very petty when you're at the flagpole at Maine State, but housing assignments are a big determination of morale at a post. And if the housing board gets hijacked by the interagency and people don't feel they're being well housed, that affects everybody's work. So you have to delve into those issues very, very quickly, but equity. The other thing I would focus more on is internal controls. I was lucky enough to have an ambassador who came from the private sector and had been working on a bank. So we actually set up a post audit committee and where we looked at different management issues and financial issues. And it became a model that GAO actually used. And it's something I've done at Post I've been, but I put more of a focus on internal controls, on the whole inspector general process. And by that, I mean our IG provides a series of questionnaires at a post. Every management officer, before even getting the post, should be reading the last inspection report, the compliance reports, what's been done, what hasn't been done. And then sadly, I've learned you have to go and you have to go check these things yourself, because even though they say they've been corrected, often they haven't. And what I learned, partly because I served at one post three times, problems are cyclical. You can solve a problem and 10 years later, it comes back again. And you have to go back and solve it again. But I put more focus on those things. These are not fashionable things. These are not the buzzwords that everybody talks about in management, but they're very, very important to success in the cone. The good part, I wish everybody told me, is that it's exciting. What I loved about my job is every day was something new. And I had the ability to decide, you know, there were things I had to do, but I had the ability to shape where we're going to go. And I also learned early on by being very proactive and having sort of a plan of what I wanted to do in place, both at Post and with Washington, I could be going up to brief the front office saying, well, here's what we're working on, rather than being told what to do, which is an interesting aspect of management work nobody explains to you. But to do that, it means you have to make sure you're covering all the details and stuff. And I guess I've been very lucky. I've worked with some of the Foreign Service greatest leaders, Ryan Crocker, Ann Patterson, and a number of people like that. Ann Patterson and I used to joke because people used to say, why do you guys always sweat the small stuff? And we used to joke because we don't have people working for us who do it for us. It's all small stuff and you have to sweat it. The last thing I just want to mention, which is an aside, is the Foreign Service offers all of us many different opportunities to engage in different ways. One of the things I did as a management officer is I became part of the State Department's team that got pulled to organize presidential visits around the world. So I might be posted in Denmark, but I'd be flown to Japan to arrange and run a presidential visit. As such, I was negotiating, you know, the detailed protocol details of a presidential visit with a foreign government. I did this in Prague, where it was the first time an American president visited since the end of the war. You get to do all these very incredible things, which bring you a lot of valid experience, which served me incredibly well later as a DCM, as an ambassador. It's taking on these roles, getting the experience, building the confidence and competence, and then doing something with it.
You know, Yolanda, if I just on this question of what might surprise you? One thing that's, I think, worth mentioning, and I'm so totally in agreement with what Ambassador Buddy was just saying, but one thing I think we haven't brought out is if you're not in a major European country, if you're in a developing country particularly, you need to accept that you are part of a tribe. What you do and how you behave reflects on the tribe. And that's a little bit shocking for people sometimes because, you know, we're very much an individualist culture in the United States. Okay, I know I have to do something at work, but once I, you know, walk out of the office, I'm my own person. I get to dress the way I want. I get to do the things I want. No, you don't. Well, at least within, you know, not 100%, but you are not only still on duty 24 hours a day, answerable for calls when you're abroad, but what you do reflects on the mission. And it can be a little different. You know, some countries are more persuasive, more open about that than others, and some very much will never understand if you're, I don't know, slovenly or dressing in odd ways or doing very strange things. It's not individual. And so when, you know, the nasty old DCM calls you in to remonstrate with you about this stuff, it can be kind of shocking. What do you mean? I'm on my own time. No, you're not. You might wish you were, and probably your DCM wishes you were, but the fact is that the whole country you're dealing with doesn't view you that way. And we can't change the culture to which we're assigned. And, you know, that doesn't mean you don't have any scope for individuality. I don't mean that at all. But this notion that you're visible, that you're a reflection on your embassy, on your tribe, that you have a collective responsibility. That can come as a cultural shock to a lot of people.
Yolanda, if I could just add to that, is that that also affects the work of a management officer. I took that same philosophy that the plaque on the front door of an embassy should never be tarnished. The flag should never be tattered. We represent the United States of America. And when somebody walks into an embassy, it shouldn't look like an abandoned Air Force base. It should look like the representation of the greatest nation on God's green earth that it's supposed to be. And the management officer has a real serious responsibility for maintaining that and making sure that you never get called in the front office to be challenged about something like that. It sounds silly, but it's not. It's very, very important. The rest of the world looks up to us, and we have a responsibility to see that.
Yolanda, before we go on, because I always like bringing things to real life. And what they're saying is just, I'm having memory after memory after memory. So when you're overseas, there are always other people in that community who are always contacting the embassy saying, come to our event, come to our event. And we really do try to make as many as we can, but we can't make all those. And so sometimes things get unfilled. I was in Ecuador one time, and we got an invitation to a block party, a neighborhood block party. This clearly had nothing to do with the government in Ecuador or the city of Guayaquil, so it wasn't the highest priority. Well, Alan didn't have anything to do on Saturday, so I said to my wife, hey, you want to go to this block party? She said, yeah, let's do it. So we drove up to the block party thinking this was no big deal. They saw our license plates and it turned into a big deal. Suddenly, everything centered around us. We were the Americans. They were so proud that we came to their block party. They started showing us through the neighborhood. They took us into their homes to show us how they were living modestly, but how proud they were, how they were keeping up their community. They have their own vocational school they had put together by themselves, and they wanted us to see the car engines they had put together. And I'll finish real quick. Before I knew it, we were sitting up at a dais, and someone from the municipality had been called and told the Americans are there. This guy put on his clothes and came down. And before you knew it, our picture was being taken and we were in the newspaper. So it's the reality of being overseas many times, as a lot of these posts. It's not a horrible thing. It's just a reality that you are representing the US government at all times. And you should be proud of that. They're giving you that respect. But, you know, just act like you deserve it.
Earn it is how it was explained to me. And thank you all for raising that. For any of you who are thinking about joining us in the Foreign Service, it as cliche as it may sound, it's a job and a lifestyle. And yes, you do go home at the end of the day, but you are always representing the United States, always.
Yolanda, when you said that, maybe slightly bad language, but when I was thinking about coming in the Foreign Service, I cornered a Foreign Service officer. I think I have to put it that way. I asked him every possible question I could think of. He told me everything he could think of. We got to this moment of silence when you've just beaten the conversation to death. And then he turned to me and he said, anywhere in life, you eat a little crap. But in the Foreign Service, you eat it off crystal, silver, and in the best of company.
I'll second that.
I wish I had something to toast to that. With that, for question, we have several questions in the chat, and we are a couple hundred people. So if you have questions, you can go ahead and use the reactions button to raise your hand. I think we can unmute ourselves. For my two interns, if you would start giving us some of those questions that are in the chat. We've seen a few things that sort of bubbled up. Let's take some frequently asked questions. One about dual citizenship. So there are not baseline preclusions for service in the Foreign Service. Everyone who joins the Foreign Service, all Foreign Service employees, generalist and specialist, have to be able to secure a top secret security clearance and also a worldwide availability medical clearance. So there's not a baseline that says if you hold a passport or a nationality from another country, you're automatically precluded. Every investigation is individual. It's going to depend on your links to that other country or countries. In some cases, people have more than one nationality, more than two nationalities. So there are no baseline preclusions. You're just going to have to put that information forward. And every diplomatic security investigation for that top secret clearance is going to be its own process. I will take some of those, Tyler and Mayarna, if you start giving us those. And again, if you have questions, it's perfectly fine to just use the raise hand function and ask it directly. I see a couple of questions too about transferring from specialist to generalist or specialist to officer. There's not a transfer process, although there are many specialists who have started their Foreign Service career as a Foreign Service specialist and then gone on to test into the Foreign Service as a Foreign Service officer or Foreign Service generalist, but there's not a transfer mechanism. Let's see, there are a couple of others. Would I recommend you taking the FSOT? Impossible to say when you should do that because we don't know, the DIRs, we have no idea what your baseline is. How much time is it gonna take you to study, et cetera. Luckily, there's a tool for that. And that tool is the FSOT practice test, which by the way, did not exist when any of the four of us joined the Foreign Service. The link is in the chat and you also received it when you registered for the session today. You received these links and attached to that email was also the suggested reading, but I'll put the link to that also, and the candidate guide. All of those materials were sent to you when you registered for the event today. So if you take the FSOT practice test, you can take it on the careers page, careers.state.gov, link in the chat, or you can take it on our app. The version on the app is slightly shorter. That is an excellent diagnostic tool because those are real test questions retired from prior iterations of the exam. At the end of that practice test, if you scroll all the way down to the bottom, don't come out of it once you're done, you can open it and see the responses. You can see which questions you got wrong or right. And in that way, you're going to be able to start your preparation, your studying, if you will, in a very focused way because you'll know exactly where you need to turn your attention. So after you have that baseline information, if you're gonna reach out to your diplomat in residence, say, I took the practice test, I scored whatever that score is, and here is how I'm preparing. That's going to give you some indication of whether or not you are in a position to register for and sit the exam in February, for example, or if you may need to take some more time and perhaps sit it in June or October. It's offered three times a year, February, June, and October, but candidates may sit the exam once in a 12-month period. So those who just sat the exam in October, if they were unsuccessful, they have to wait until October 2022 to take it again. So with that, we'll take a couple of questions. Edwina, you can unmute yourself and direct your question to whoever it is that you'd like to answer.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for the opportunity to listen in and to hear the day-to-day operations. My question is, I'm in the process of completing my PhD in conflict resolution and analysis here in South Florida. And I'm just wondering, I know you talked a lot about the tests, but can you tell us if there is a pathway as I'm completing my degree towards getting into the Foreign Service as opposed to focusing on the tests?
The mechanism for the Foreign Service officer or generalist track, those five career tracks, is to sit the Foreign Service officer test. Some of you may be familiar with the Pickering and Rangel programs, which Yolanda laments she did not know about when she was joining the Foreign Service. It's a wonderful program. It's a mentorship program. So for the 2 years of that program, you're matched with someone who will mentor you. It's a fellowship program because it pays for 2 years of graduate study. It's an internship program. There's a domestic internship at the in the United States, either in the State Department in a bureau or an office or on the Hill with a member of Congress for the Rangel Fellowship. But most importantly, it's an employment program. All of those programs lead to employment as Foreign Service officers. But even with those programs, you must take and pass the FSOT and the Foreign Service Oral Assessment. So the entry process to the Foreign Service is to sit the exam. I've put a link, I'll put it again. The next FSOT overview will be on Saturday, January 8th at 2 p.m. Eastern. The registration is in the chat. I'll put it again. Anesthesis Scroggins, you can pose your question.
Hi, everyone, and I appreciate you guys, Lynette, joining on the different programs within management. So I have two questions, if that's okay, or I can just answer or ask one. Okay. So my first question is there a physical agility test you complete before becoming a service foreign service officer?
It's not a physical agility test, but we can put a link to medical clearances. You must be worldwide available to serve in the Foreign Service, medically worldwide available. And so what I'll do now is put a link to the page that describes medical clearances. And your second question?
Thank you. And then my second question would be, could you continue your education while being a foreign service officer overseas?
Very difficult. So Yolanda was a doctoral candidate when she joined the Foreign Service. Her parents were very, very concerned that she was never going to finish and defend that dissertation. She did so, but I gotta tell you, it's rough working with any job, right? It's rough working and also being in school. So while it is not impossible, and while there are some specific programs for some mid and senior level officers, many of our senior level leadership have studied at some of the defense universities, working and being in school, I would not advise it. I survived it. I really wouldn't advise it.
Can I chime in on that one? Please. Because I get this question a lot as DIR South. And I always tell people, if you're looking at some other career as well, the one I hear the most is law school. I always tell them, go ahead and do it. Go be a lawyer. I know enough lawyers. You do it a few years, you're not gonna wanna do it much more. You're gonna come back to us. So I always tell them, don't plan on coming in entry level to Foreign Service and then leaving to go somewhere else. Because we spend a lot of money on bringing people in at the beginning, getting them trained so they can perform at a high level for the next 20 years. And so if you're not sure about the career, there's no rush trying to join. So go ahead and do whatever you want to do in life and then decide at a certain point if you want to go ahead and sit for that exam.
Chad, hi.
Hi, quick question. So made it through the test, the QEP, taking my oral assessment soon under the management cone. Thank you. Just wanted any last minute tips for the day-long interview process, anything you recommend? I know the process has probably changed or it's been a long time since you've gone through that day. But any-
Wait a minute. What do you say, long time? How long ago?
So 2 years.
A few years ago. So when you received your invitation to the FOSOA, to the Foreign Service Oral Assessment, you should also have received an invitation to an overview of the FOSOA that would have come from our wonderful colleague, Jim Ellickson Brown. If you have not received that invitation, stick around afterward and we can put you in touch. You've heard from Jim. So you will take that overview and that is going to prepare you for that day. This process, by the way, did not exist when any of the four of us were joining the Foreign Service. It is meant to demystify that day, to help you understand what you can expect from that day, which of the Foreign Service dimensions will be assessed during which portion of the day. So it's not meant for you to go in blind or it to be a mystery. So that's how you're going to prepare for that day. In addition to the candidate guide, which should have been attached to your confirmation for today.
Yep, thank you.
Yeah, okay. When I took that exam, that was shortly after Noah parked the ark. Nothing I can tell you.
And again, before you move on, one caveat is be cautious of any external sources. Reddit or anything you hear on the internet, or your cousins, brothers, friends, uncle. Sometimes they're well-meaning people, but it's antiquated information, or who knows. But the bottom line is all the information you need, Yolanda's already talked about, and that's pretty much it. You know your body and yourself better than anybody else. Do whatever you can do to stay calm and cool and feel good about yourself before you enter. Good night's sleep. Just kind of the common sense thing you do before any interview.
Thank All right. you.
I don't want to beat up on this too much. Please, Ambassador Bodie.
I think getting a good night's sleep is critical. And the other thing is when I was preparing to go to grad school, the dean of my program has said a very interesting thing. It's a test, folks. It's a day. It's not a measure of how good a human being you are. It's a predictor of how successful you might be as an FSO. You do the best you can. Be articulate as you can. You're not competing against the people in there. That's another thing where it's not there's no gaming. It's just be straightforward and articulate and get some rest and probably have a cup of coffee and some orange juice to get your blood sugar going before you go.
No one will believe us when I tell it. But I want, before we leave this chat, and I don't want to beat up too much on some of these online resources, but we cannot control what a group of strangers may tell you in a forum. All right. So we've seen some of the stuff in there in the various forums, and some of it is horrifying because it's so wrong and people are speaking with a great deal of authority. And some of them are having a good time with you guys. So I've seen some where they say, oh, I'm going to orals on Thursday. And then Alan and I are like looking at the list like, no, you're not. So just be very careful about what you consume. And then there are a couple of things out there. You can pay some guy $30 a month to basically, he writes various DIRs and gets the information that you could get from us if you wrote us ourselves. There is nothing that you have to pay for. Your government has created careers.state.gov for a reason, and that is to make sure that you have accurate information. Even if you have friends, cousins, et cetera, who are in the Foreign Service, unless they've joined the Foreign Service since October of 2021, that process, some part of that testing process has changed. So the 16 DIRs are available to you to make sure that you have the latest and greatest. And the last thing is there's a document out there that you can buy. It's $9.95. I'm going to save you $9.95. Do not buy it, because I was curious, what is this thing? So I bought it and I downloaded it. It's the career guide that I attached to your confirmation for today in a different font. So don't buy that one. So
I just want to throw in one other thing too.
Please.
Don't get your entire ego and personality wound around this. You know, if you don't pass, come back in a year. I did not pass the Foreign Service written the first time I took it. It was a hell of a shock. But the fact is, you know, three ambassadors and 37 years in the career later, it didn't really matter. So if you don't pass it the first time, you know, pick yourself up, dust yourself off, and go back and do it again.
Ditto here.
So I see a question about should we apply first or take the FSOT? The FSOT is the beginning of the application process to become a Foreign Service officer. That's the beginning of that process. Jesse, hi. Unmute yourself and ask your question.
My question was, during the pandemic, there's been like a lot of resignations and a lot of just issues with HR. Has the State Department been affected at all?
Our attrition rate is actually surprisingly low. Folks love being in the Foreign Service, which is not to say that people don't leave and we have people who are not retained, but overall our numbers are quite good. So some of that is tied to sort of lifestyle issues, and I'll give you a snapshot. For folks who come in directly out of grad school, let's say, and for women particularly, they've been in the Foreign Service for 5-7 years or something, and then life stuff starts to happen. So I was single when I joined the Foreign Service. I married a UN diplomat. We have a son. So the types of life stuff that starts to happen is, you know, is this going to work for my family? What about my elder care issues? My mother's had brain surgery twice. Historically, and this is not unique to the State Department, when those types of decisions and those types of compromises have to be made for family, overwhelmingly, it's women who do so. So when you look at the numbers of young women in particular who join the Foreign Service and leave for whatever reason, a lot of it is linked to family issues, but that's the case in every industry. That's the case at Pfizer, that's the case at Raytheon, et cetera. So the answer to your question is our retention rate is actually quite good, but there are pockets of retention where we see certain, you know, demographics of people who come into the Foreign Service who leave after X amount of time.
Okay, thank you.
And you can find that. There's a link to our workforce stats also in the chat, right?
Yolanda, I think it's worth mentioning too, though, is that the pandemic has been hard on everybody, certainly everybody here at home. But it's been particularly hard on people in the Foreign Service in that they're far away. While the institution has done everything they can to take care of them medically, not being able to travel, travel plans being disrupted. I know from my own family's case where not being able to see grandchildren because they can't travel. But this is no different than any other international organization. But it's not to say that it hasn't impacted. It will impact, but the institution does what it can to make it work. And as a management officer, the morale of the post, how well the post responds to a crisis like this, is largely on your shoulders. So keep that in mind.
Very much so. Thank you, sir. NC, ask your question. Unmute yourself and ask your question. NC?
Oh, hello. Can you see me? Hi, hello everyone. Thank you for such an informative session. I'm trying to get a question, answer to a question that I've been looking this answer for a while, and I hope you at least know it or give me guidance where to find it. So I'm currently working for United Nations and have an extensive career in the government and the private sector in a variety of capacities. And now, since my child is in college and there's nothing stopping me here in the States, and I'm ready to venture around the world, and this career sounds like what I want to do. And my question is how I can transition from UN to the Foreign Service. I know a colleague of mine has done it, but I cannot find information about it. So that is my question.
Briefly, there's not a transition from agencies. So there's not, we get this question from Department of Defense as well. Is there a way for me to transfer from one agency to another? There isn't. The entry process for the Foreign Service, per the Foreign Service Act, is the FSOT. The beginning process is to sit the Foreign Service Officer test.
But she told me that there is an alternative route. She didn't sit for the Foreign Service test. That's my question. What is that alternative route?
We have two diplomats in residence here, and there is not an alternative route to transfer into the Foreign Service. I don't control what someone said, and perhaps there's some civil service route that she's taken, but for the Foreign Service, even if there are fellowships, there are the two fellowships we talked about, those fellows must also take and pass the FSOT and the FSOA, the Foreign Service Oral Assessment.
Okay, so I have to apply and then be selected and continue the process.
That is correct.
Okay, thank you very much.
Please, Ambassador Newman.
Gone into the civil service because, you know, the Foreign Service has three different personnel. I mean, the State Department has three personnel systems. The Foreign Service, which is heavily abroad. The civil service, which is mostly in the United States, which has completely different rules. And then we have the local personnel overseas. So it's, and people sometimes use terms loosely. I went into the State Department, I became a diplomat. So they may have gone into the civil service, but it's a different operation.
I know she was stationed for a couple years in Africa, then she was moved back to Florida. So I don't know, the civil service they stay in the States. Well, she was been sent to different duty stations. So I don't think it was the civil service.
She's gone in as a specialist, depending on what her jobs are.
Or a contractor. Yes.
So what is that like? What do you mean foreign contractor?
Can I jump in?
Please. Yeah,
can I jump in now?
Mm-hmm.
So basically, this is one of these, what we're seeing is one of these people, someone said maybe kind of sort of things, and this happens a lot. And that's why I always talk to candidates when they come to me with these sort of stories, is that we don't know. We know the processes. And so what people have a tendency to frequently tell us is a portion of their experience. So the process, the standard process, the FSOT, for anybody who's going to be join the U.S. Foreign Service as a generalist, and those who are going to enter as a specialist, take their version. And this can all be found at careers.state.gov. There are opportunities for fellows, but they still take the test. As a civil servant, they can apply for positions through usajobs.gov. but there's not a transition program from the civil service to the foreign service. So in this case, careers.state.gov is the best source for the different processes. If the colleague, you're still in touch with that colleague, you might ask them some details, and then that might be able to help.
Yes, that's, I lost touch with her. That's why I'm trying to get an answer to this. But thank you. Thank you very much for your answer.
All right.
Lydia, unmute yourself and ask your question.
Hello, everyone. I already sent my question on the panel. I just would like to know the requirement, the qualification to join the US department here. So I need more clarification.
To join as a Foreign Service officer, as we're discussing this evening, in any of the five generalist career tracks, the requirements are very straightforward. One must be an American citizen between the ages of 21 and 60 years old on the day that you swear in. And so that's the age requirement. And then the process to join is to sit the Foreign Service Officer test onward to the Foreign Service Oral Assessment. Those with the highest scores coming out of the Foreign Service Oral Assessment are offered invitations to join as Foreign Service employees. Those with the highest scores receive those invitations first. So
yeah, I got that, but I'm was asking. I don't have American nationality. My mother has, but not me. I'm living here in Senegal. Was just asking how what is the selection criteria? How to join if you apply? You know how it's going to happen?
So
is there any specification?
Our selection process is quite transparent. It was in the selection guide that was attached to the email when you registered for today. So
can can I jump in again? Because I'm seeing questions in chat and also for time purposes. As my colleague mentioned, one of the requirements is that you have US citizenship. Doesn't matter if you were naturalized or you were born in the US, that is still one of the requirements. Each candidate will have to get a medical clearance and a top secret security clearance. So the top secret security clearance requires US citizenship. So those are pretty much check off the box requirements. You can find more details at careers.state.gov. Now, I do want to take this opportunity while you're talking about some of the requirements, because I see questions about mid-career and older people joining. And so I just want to drop this in there. Join or take the test when you feel like you're comfortable. Don't think you're late. I remember talking to a guy who was a captain in the military, and he said, oh, I missed my window. And I'm thinking, you're about 28 years old. You're prime time. So basically, it doesn't matter if you're 50 years old. I think the oldest person in my class when I joined was about 54. Yeah, the skew is going to be a little bit younger, but it's probably not as young as you think. And just keep in mind that the criteria that stands out more than anything else in the selection committee is those 13 dimensions you can find at careers.state.gov. So if you go to careers.state.gov and look at those 13 dimensions and you look at it and say, oh, yeah, I remember that. Oh, I got a story about this. Basically, it's like a piece of cake to you because you've had enough experience of living those 13 dimensions. You know, you're probably going to be a good candidate. Whereas if you're one of these people who has five dimensions and the rest you're trying to figure out how you're going to get them, maybe you need a little more season.
Great. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Pat, hi. Unmute yourself and ask your question.
Good morning, good afternoon. It is currently 3 a.m. in Saudi Arabia, and I've actually decided to take the initiative just to expand my horizons. And I would like to ask, as I'm currently abroad, what steps or like what experiences do you guys recommend, actually, like as an American, when you guys spoke about the tribe and being a representation? Absolutely. Like, you come here, that little blue passport, doesn't matter where in the US you're from, you're an American. That accent will give you away like this. But I want to capitalize on my experience here. And basically, I'm just working my way up to the Foreign Service. I understand the entry level, and you know, I don't mind, you know, starting from counselor. That's great. That's, I need a steady mold. So two things. How can I capitalize on my experience abroad? That's one. And two, when you guys refer to like these smaller posts, could you guys just give an example, more or less? Not to say I'm not interested in Europe, but I'm not really that interested in Europe. I more kind of want to go east anyway. So just like, could you guys expand a little bit on that? Thank you.
Sure. Ambassador Bodie, you've had some interesting tours.
Sure. Well, a couple things. When we talk about smaller posts, we either talk about smaller countries and smaller embassies, but we also have small posts within larger countries where we have our consulates and consulate generals. I served in Hamburg, which is a consulate general with about, when I was there, I think we had about 10 Americans there. And we have those around the world. Just very briefly to your experience about your question about your overseas experience. One of the things I think we look for is how comfortable one is living in a foreign culture and getting around and doing work in a foreign culture. So if you're living in Saudi Arabia now, how do you handle that? How do you handle that being as American? And what's the work you do? How do you interact with the local government, the local, whatever work you are doing, and what that brings to experience? Obviously, someone who has that experience when they're taking the test and coming into the Foreign Service has a slight leg up because you've done that. And you've done that in a culture that's quite different than most of the United States. The second thing I'd want to stress is language ability. I don't know if you're studying Arabic or your ability there, but if I just implore anybody who's overseas when they're working in a country and living in a country, take advantage of the opportunity and become fluent in that language. We have certain deficit languages in the Foreign Service. After you get to a certain point in the hiring process, you get credit if you have, I don't know what they are right now, but I'm sure Arabic is still one of them. So take advantage of those things because it's really important that you, when you have that ability and that opportunity to learn a skill like that, to take advantage of it. And I just speak as an old guy. Those are things, take advantage of. You think you're busy now, this is the time you have the time to go learn a language when you're not addressing all these other career issues. Take advantage of it and make the most of it. The other thing I would also is international organizations when you're overseas, like Rotary or anything you can do that gets you out in the local community, meeting a wide variety of different people, are all things that can only help you in achieve success and you're getting into the Foreign Service.
Such excellent advice. And Kat, I want to thank you for joining us the wee hours of the morning. We had quite a few who were joining us from overseas. This really speaks to the importance, I feel, of this series. And again, my thanks to the Academy for hosting us and for providing us with this information. I want to be respectful of everyone's time. I'll remind you that there are the next session for this series, the final session, will focus on the consular career track. That will be on Saturday, December 11th at 2 p.m. Eastern. So there are a couple of things. There are several questions. We, the 16 diplomats in residence, want you to not be a stranger. We are here because the State Department wants us to give you accurate information about joining the Foreign Service if that's your desire. So don't be a stranger. Reach out to your diplomat in residence. If you're overseas, you can absolutely and should reach out to the diplomat in residence who covers wherever your legal residence is. And so with that, I would like very much again, Ambassador Bodie, thank you. Ambassador Newman, thank you. And I will give you the last word.
Thank you, Yolanda. One little correction, by the way, I'm not technically a Foreign Service brat. My father was an immigrant from Austria, and he would have joined the Foreign Service if he could have, but there was, in those days, there was an age cap, which we don't have now. And by the time he got his citizenship, he, after World War II, or in the Army in World War II, he couldn't join the Foreign Service, so he became a political science professor. And then he went an odd route. He was a political appointee. He was a Republican appointed by President Johnson to serve in Afghanistan, who was retained by President Nixon, and then under President Ford went to Morocco, and then was out in the Carter years, and then under President Reagan went to Saudi Arabia. And so he was a political appointee who served four presidents, three posts, and two parties. We don't have too many of those.
So that was my way of calling you a brat on the sly. Can I share a little tidbit? You may know that Ambassador Newman and his father there are not many people who have a parent as a diplomat or as an ambassador. He is one of the few of those couples, but he is also one of the very few where he served as ambassador in the same country as his father. He was ambassador to Afghanistan, as was your father. Am I correct?
That is absolutely correct. Anyway, pardon me for that brief excursion into personal history. I'm really glad you're doing this. I hope you're able to answer all the hundreds of other questions that I see in the chat that we didn't get to. And I'm delighted to see this interest. And boy, I think you've just heard some great stuff from Alan and from Ambassador Bodie. And I hope people are paying attention.
Thanks so much. We hope to see you on Saturday for the last in this five-part series. Yes, they are recorded. Yes, we're going to caption them so that you will be able to review them at your leisure. And our thanks to the Academy for posting them on their website once they are captioned. So with that, thank you so much and have a good night.
Thank you. Good night.